Mary Estelle. Mary Estelle, Some Reflections Upon Marriage. Mary Estelle was an English feminist writer and rhetorician. Her advocacy of equal educational opportunities for women has earned her the title the first English feminist. Few records of Mary Estelle's life have survived. As biographer Ruth Perry explains, as a woman she had little or no business in the world of commerce, politics, or law. She was born, she died, she owned a small house for some years, she kept a bank account, she helped to open a charity school in Chelsea, these facts the public listings can supply. Only four of her letters were saved, and these because they had been written to important men of the period. Researching the biography, Perry uncovered more letters and manuscript fragments, but she notes that if Estelle had not written to wealthy aristocrats who could afford to pass down entire estates, very little of her life would have survived. Mary Estelle was born in Newcastle upon Tyne on November 12, 1666, to Peter and Mary Estelle. Her parents had two other children, William, who died in infancy, and Peter, her younger brother. She was baptized in St. John's Church in Newcastle. Her family was upper middle class and lived in Newcastle throughout her early childhood. Her father was a conservative royalist Anglican who managed a local coal company. As a woman, Mary received no formal education, although she did receive an informal education from her uncle when she was eight, an ex-clergyman named Ralph Estelle whose bouts with alcoholism prompted his suspension from the Church of England. Though suspended from the church, he was affiliated with the Cambridge-based philosophical school that based its teachings around philosophers such as Aristotle, Plato, and Pythagoras. Her father died when she was 12 years old, leaving her without a dowry. With the remainder of the family finances invested in her brother's higher education, Mary and her mother relocated to live with Mary's aunt. After the death of her mother and aunt in 1688, Estelle moved to Chelsea, London, where she was fortunate enough to become acquainted with a circle of literary and influential women, including Lady Mary Chudleigh, Elizabeth Thomas, Judith Drake, Elizabeth Elstob, and Lady Mary Wortley Montagu. These women assisted in the development and publication of her work. She was also in contact with the Archbishop of Canterbury, William Sancroft, who was known for his charitable works. Sancroft assisted Estelle financially and, furthermore, introduced her to her future publisher. She was one of the first English women, following Bethshua Macon, to advocate the idea that women were just as rational as men, and just as deserving of education. First published in 1694, her serious proposal to the ladies for the advancement of their true and greatest interest presents a plan for an all-female college where women could pursue a life of the mind. In 1700, Estelle published Some Reflections Upon Marriage. She wittily critiques the philosophical underpinnings of the institution of marriage in 1700s England, warning women of the dangers of a hasty or ill-considered choice. The Duchess of Mazarin is used as an example of the dangers of an ill education and unequal marriage. Estelle argues that education will help women to make better matrimonial choices and meet the challenges of the married state. She has need of a strong reason, of a truly Christian and well-tempered spirit, of all the assistance the best education can give her, and ought to have some good assurance of her own firmness and virtue, who ventures on such a trial. Estelle warns that disparity in intelligence, character, and fortune may lead to misery, and recommends that marriage be based on lasting friendship rather than short-lived attraction. A woman should look for a good understanding, a virtuous mind, and in all other respects let there be as much equality as may be. Estelle expanded on this theme in response to critics in the third edition of Some Reflections Upon Marriage. After withdrawing from public life in 1709, she founded a charity school for girls in Chelsea as a token of the Society for the Propagation of Christian Knowledge, organizing the school's curriculum herself with likely financial support from her patrons Lady Catherine Jones and Lady Elizabeth Hastings. When she was 60 years old, Estelle was invited to live with Lady Catherine Jones, where she resided until her death. Estelle died in 1731. A few months after a mastectomy to remove a cancerous right breast. In her last days, she refused to see any of her acquaintances and stayed in a room with her coffin, thinking only of God. She was buried in the churchyard of Chelsea Church in London. Estelle is remembered for her ability to debate freely with both contemporary men and women, and particularly for her groundbreaking methods of negotiating the position of women in society by engaging in philosophical debate rather than basing her arguments in historical evidence as had previously been attempted. Descartes' theory of dualism, a separate mind and body, allowed Estelle to promote the idea that women as well as men had the ability to reason, and subsequently they should not be treated so poorly. If all men are born free, why are all women born slaves? All of Mary Estelle's works were published anonymously. Estelle's two best-known books, A Serious Proposal to the Ladies, for the Advancement of Their True and Greatest Interest, and A Serious Proposal, Part 2, outline her plan to establish a new type of institution for women to assist in providing women with both religious and secular education. She suggests extending women's career options beyond mother and nun. Estelle wanted all women to have the same opportunity as men to spend eternity in heaven with God, and she believed that for this they needed to be educated and to understand their experiences. The nunnery-style education she proposed would enable women to live in a protected environment, without the influences of the external patriarchal society. Her proposal was never adopted because critics said it seemed too Catholic for the English. Later, her ideas about women were satirized in The Tatler by the writer Jonathan Swift. While the writer Daniel Defoe admired the first part of Estelle's proposal, he believed that her recommendations were impracticable. However, Patricia Springborg notes that Defoe's own recommendation for an academy for women, as detailed in his essay upon projects, did not significantly differ from Estelle's original proposal. Despite this, she was still an intellectual force in London's educated classes. A few years later, Estelle published the second part of A Serious Proposal, detailing her own vision of women's education for courtly ladies. She broke away from the contemporary rhetorical style of the period where orators spoke before an audience for learning, and instead offered a conversational style of teaching neighbors the proper way of behavior. She referred only to the Port Royal logic as a source of contemporary influence, though still relied upon classical rhetorical theories as she presented her own original ideas. In her presentation, she offered that rhetoric, as an art, does not require a male education to be master, and listed the means of which a woman could acquire the necessary skills from natural logic, which established Estelle as a capable female rhetorician. In the early 1690s, Estelle entered into correspondence with John Norris of Bemerton, after reading Norris's practical discourses upon several divine subjects. The letters illuminate Estelle's thoughts on God and theology. Norris thought the letters worthy of publication and had them published with Estelle's consent as letters concerning the love of God. Her name did not appear in the book, but her identity was soon discovered and her rhetorical style was much lauded by contemporaries. One of Estelle's notable contributions to 18th century ideas of female friendship rests on the political exigencies of forming alliances. Jacqueline Broad views Estelle's bond of friendship as more Aristotelian, where alliances are formed for the sake of virtuous reciprocity. However, Nancy Kendrick does not accept Broad's viewpoint. She feels Estelle's theory of friendship is determinately anti-Aristotelian. Although Estelle embraced the Aristotelian friendship of moral virtue, Kendrick claims that Estelle treated virtuous friends as those who love one another for who they essentially are and not just for reciprocity's sake. Contrary to Aristotle, Estelle contends that authentic virtuous friendship arose from the divine nature of God, thus becoming spiritual friendship. Furthermore, Estelle, unlike Aristotle, saw this love in friendship extending toward one's enemies because divine love embraces all of mankind. However, her emphasis on religion's importance to female friendship and feminist thought has rankled contemporary critics of her work. Estelle considered herself a self-reliant, modern female, one who was on a definite mission to rescue her sex from the oppression of males. Having never received a formal education, Estelle believed that women should be educated in a spiritual environment, away from society with only other females. She felt the world was so corrupt because of being under male dominance that women should receive an education free of male influence. Estelle argued that women should receive an education equal to men and should be able to refrain from marrying if they so desire. However, if they should marry, then they must be subjected to the will of their husbands. Marriage. Estelle viewed herself as self-reliant and took pride advancing her mission to rescue her sex without the help of male authority, whom she felt kept women in a place of subjugation. George Ballard, Estelle 18th century biographer, stated that although she never married, she had proposed to by an eminent clergyman but the marriage negotiations broke down, leaving Estelle disappointed. Politics. Having been exposed in her youth to violent political situations such as civil unrest and riots in the streets of Newcastle is probably what helped develop her interest in politics. She had idealized King Charles I and viewed his successors, William and Mary, as illegitimate rulers to the throne of England.